So I really enjoyed. I don't think I've ever talked to you about The Escapist, which I really dig.
Oh, cool.
And have you found more people now because of Apes and also this? They're revisiting The Escapist and saying.
Yeah, I mean, it's actually Netflix as well has given it a whole lease of life that it never had because it didn't really get much distribution theatrically. We came out without, you know, obviously we'd talk about The Gambler, but I mean, in brief, it basically we were in this bizarre position where we were with a UK distributor who didn't really put a lot of time and money into it. They had another movie, Bronson, the same year.
Yeah, I remember.
Which they'd financed, so they put all their money into that. And so we kind of got dumped at the UK box office, and they kept on promising more press if we got good reviews, and then we got good reviews, but they didn't do it. Anyway, long story short, no one saw it. And then in the US, we sold the film at Sundance to Think Film, and they went bankrupt like 2 months after. So we were kind of caught up in this whole issue, and luckily IFC came to our rescue, and they put the movie out. But it was a challenging process getting the movie out. So definitely making Apes certainly put people's focus back on the movie, which was really good.
Really good movie. I think I saw it at Sundance.
Okay.
I was going to say I couldn't remember if it was TIFF or Sundance, but it must have been Sundance.
Yeah, it was Sundance. Yeah.
And I was like, fuck, this is a good movie. You know, but anyway, jumping into why I get to talk to you today. So how long was your first cut on this versus what people are seeing on screen?
Why do you ask that?
I always like asking that. I ask directors because
it's funny, because I was just not that I should be reading reviews, but at this stage, but I was just reading saying it feels like it was a 10-hour miniseries cut down, which is,
oh, I don't mean it like that.
No, and my first cut was nothing spectacularly long, to be honest. It was about 220.
Okay.
Which you know, for a first cut, there normally you can go 4 hours. So it was 220, and then what we did actually a lot in the edit, Pete Bedreau, the editor, and I, we sort of shape shifted it because Bill's phenomenal and I think very unique strengths as a screenwriter is his this sort of stream of consciousness ability that he has. He has this ability and very fresh ability to sort of put you in a situation and let characters sing. You know, he's very Shakespearean.
Sure.
But the thing for me when I was putting this movie together in post was the challenge for me was the structure. You know, what is it that's propelling this character through these various worlds? What is his quest, I guess? And you could argue that it doesn't need a quest. It could be very freewheeling in the way that Hal Ashby movies are. But I always felt like we needed something propulsive, and obviously the third act has that in the movie in spades, in terms of once he's sort of up against the ropes and other people are involved and in danger like Lamar, and you get a sense of his drive and his purpose. But for the first two acts, it's this sort of navigation through life, and I think that's an interesting challenge to put that in front of a modern audience whose expectations normally are cause and effect storytelling, certainly as a studio movie.
I'm very curious about, listen, I'm a big fan of Bill's work, as I've said repeatedly. How is it collaborating with him? Like, I know he is a, I'm very curious from when he gives you the script, how much is there collaboration back and forth? How much is it like the draft he gives you is really fucking good and you're like, yeah.
Well, it's purely personal from my point of view. I had gone from after Apes, I set out on this path of wanting to do my own thing. I wrote The Escapist with Daniel Hardy, my writing partner, and so. But for the last two times now, I've done other people's scripts, and for me as a filmmaker, and this, you know, some directors can do this brilliantly, and I don't think I can. But to come into something that pre-exists. And make it your own is sometimes very challenging, and more often than not, as a filmmaker, you want to change stuff, you want to redevelop it, you want to you know, shift something, you want to come at it from a different angle. And the interesting challenge is when, especially in the studio system, when a movie's greenlit, no one wants to change anything. It's got to go in the way that it's set up. So I'd kind of gone through various opportunities with other projects where I saw the great potential in the scripts, but I wanted to do stuff to it, and that just didn't work out. So I promised myself not to waste other people's time or waste my own time, to basically just take something. If I found something that was exactly what I wanted to do, then and I saw it, like, you know, saw it in the sense that this is the movie that I want to make. And when I read Bill's script, it just came alive. It jumped off the page, and I could visualize all of the sequences. And so I kind of knew, in a way, like, there's nothing I want to do to this, you know. And then, of course, when you get into it, there is stuff you need to do to it, like always, you know. Scripts are scripts, and movies are movies. But it was an amazing blueprint to work from.
It's in the teaser trailer, so I'm not giving anything away. I'm against spoilers.
Okay.
But it's out there that there's a great bunch of lines using the term fuck you.
Yeah.
You know, and since that's out there, let's talk about it.
Yeah.
When you read that in the script, you were like, I'm doing this. Was it like that part of the script that you're like, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that scene for sure. When it's spoken by John Goodman as well, it's extraordinary. But, there's many moments in this movie, I feel, that have that. You know, he's a very unusual Hollywood screenwriter in this day and age, because he writes with such, I don't know, it's Shakespearean in a way. He has such color to his language. Do you know what I mean? I don't mean that in a kind of blue way, but in the sense that the interaction between Jim and his mother is so. It's kind of elevated. It's a little Tarantino-esque, I guess, in the sense that he writes how most people don't talk, because we don't have that level of articulation. But it's really alluring as a result of that. So I would read scenes. On the first read, I was like, holy crap, I could be shooting that. And then the fuck you scene, which to me was emblematic of what this movie's about. I'm sorry.
Oh, no, it's fine.
Which is essentially, you know, there's this guy who is essentially the devil. John Goodman plays the devil. And he's a very avuncular devil in many ways, and a very, very kind of enticing devil, as most devils are. But he's a guy who believes in material wealth, building up yourself, that fortress of solitude, so you get to say fuck you to the world. Whereas Mark's character, Jim, and that's why he ends up without, I don't want to spoil anything, but he ends up in a very different place at the end. And it's all about what it means to be able to say fuck you, what it means to be true to yourself. And you know, it's all, we all go through life in a way, and that's what, for me, what the notion of the gambler is. It's like the choices we make in life. You know, if you want to climb one of two mountains, and there's a mountain close to you, and it's not that high, and it's easy to climb, and there's a mountain over there that's incredibly high and difficult to climb, which is the better mountain to climb? And some might say it's better to go for the big mountain, because even if you fail, you at least try to do your very best. Because if you fail at climbing the small mountain, you know, it's a lose-lose. And I think that sort of sums up the movie for me. It's a guy who's really striving to be the very truthful notion of what he can be.
Before I run out of time, which is going to happen rather quick, unfortunately, have to ask you, did you see Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, and what did you think? Obviously, I mean, I love your Apes movie. I'm just curious what you thought about what Matt did.
I did see it, yeah, and
am I putting you on the spot?
yeah, but that's fine. I mean, I thought it was beautifully directed. It's an incredibly well made film. It's hard, you know, because I very much wanted to do the sequel. I was very passionate about doing the sequel and other films. I love that franchise, and,
sure.
And I'm thrilled in a way for Matt and what he achieved with that, because he achieved something that I probably couldn't have, because he just did something different. He's his own filmmaker. I'm a different filmmaker. So it's great that he's had success with that film and the fact that the franchise lives. Do you know what I mean? That's what we're all hoping for. So for that, I was thrilled when watching it. I just had a very different take and a very different idea of what the movie was going to be. So it's always going to be colored by that. And I think, you know...
Have you ever said what you were planning on doing, or has it always been like under wraps? I don't actually know.
I don't know. I haven't really. No. I mean, to be honest, it's not that different, I guess. I mean, for me, revolutions, the majority of revolutions... probably the American Revolution aside, 9 times out of 10 result in civil war. You know, a revolution happens and then it fragments and you have a civil war. So we always set out on that path of Caesar and Cobra.
Sure.
You know, in a way, becoming the Malcolm X or Martin Luther King of the revolution and the clash as a result of that. I think the fundamental thing that I wanted to do, which I think the franchise will probably do, and I haven't talked specifically to Matt or Mark Bomback, the writer, about where they're going with this, but I would imagine that the thing that they're going to go to was what I was hoping to do with the sequel, which is go into the cities, evolve technically, sort of figure out the combustion engine, sort of in a way interact with our society. And for me, I found that fascinating. And I guess what Matt wanted to do, and obviously it was his first Apes film, was play out more the interim aspect of it, keep them in the forest for longer and stuff. So that was the fundamental difference, I think, between our takes on it.
Definitely have to ask you. I would imagine that you have read also many scripts since doing The Gambler, and before The Gambler, deciding on that. What are you thinking about doing? Because what's interesting is you went from a smaller movie to this huge movie,
yeah.
And now you just did a smaller movie.
Medium movie.
Well, I don't know what. I don't ask budget questions, but a
right.
smaller movie.
Yeah.
Are you looking to do like one of the big superhero franchise movies at like Marvel or DC, or are you thinking about, you know, a more character-based small film? Like, I would imagine you have a lot of choices right now.
I hope so. I don't know. I mean, I've not been asked by Marvel to do anything, and I love, you know, like most of us, I guess it's all about story and storytelling. And what I loved about making The Escapist, even though you never get to make your first movie again in terms of the experience, because most first movies take years to make. I mean, The Escapist took me 5 years to get together, and it was really because of Brian Cox and his loyalty to that movie and being able to build a cast around him that we got that movie done. But going into that, I knew everything. I knew where the bodies were buried. I knew every scene. I knew how I was going to shoot it. I lived and breathed that movie. And I think when your career starts to accelerate, it becomes harder to do that. You have other obligations. You know, I have a family now. So I think, you know, at the end of the day, you have to stay completely immersed in your work. And sometimes that can be a challenge. And I think what I do next is going to be going back to the ethos of The Escapist, in the sense that I'm building something from the ground up myself.
So you're writing something?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And I'm making something that is in the science fiction world.
I read about this. It's called Full... I have the name in my pocket.
What's that?
The title of this.
No, I haven't told anyone.
Oh.
No.
It was called... Maybe it's something you're doing for someone else. Hold on. I wrote down... Echo Chamber.
Oh, no, that's a TV show. That's a TV show that I'm working on, which is going to be years in the making. I don't know when that'll happen, but I hope it happens soon. But it's the same. It's my co-writer, Daniel Hardy, who I wrote The Escapist with. But this is this will be a feature, and it's sci-fi and just very grounded again. And I just love science fiction as a genre because it gives you the opportunity to sort of smuggle very, very current ideas and a reflection of who we are into what is essentially mainstream cinema. For me, a huge part of filmmaking is there, obviously, to entertain. You know, there's a reason why a cinema is stacked like that. It's there to bring an audience and to involve an audience. And I think, you know, one doesn't have to be mutually exclusive. You don't have to just make firework displays. It's really about challenging the audience and provoking the audience. And I think Hollywood as a place will live and thrive if it's able to continue doing that. What I want to do next is kind of the Holy Grail. It's making something. Rian Johnson did it very successfully, I think, with Looper, where you get to make a piece that really represents what you want to do, and you can do that in a mainstream way. And that's my goal next.
Yeah, I'm a huge fan of Rian's work and super happy he landed. A lot of people are upset that I know you got to go, but like a lot of people are upset that some of the best minds are ending up with Star Wars movies.
Yeah.
And I'm personally like, fuck,
oh, great.
Yes.
Great.
Because I want these movies to be great.
Yeah.
And we're getting great directors on them.
Yeah, Gareth as well. It's terrific. It's really great.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Yeah. So, you know, and it is, it's sort of, the franchises are becoming so, all consuming sounds too negative because... But it is that thing where there must be room for original stuff to grow because they've got to be franchises of the future. There has to be stuff that, you know, and for me, what I'm doing next will hopefully become a franchise. Will become very ambitious, and but I want to, in the best way, like if you imagine The Matrix was made on a pretty decent, relatively small budget.
Yep.
It was economic. Same with The Terminator. It was made for $8 million, and I think for me the idea would be to do something in that vein and then build it out.
Yeah, basically make it at a budget and hope for the best, and if it works, get to make more.
Exactly.
I completely understand. Sir, it is a pleasure to talk with you.
Likewise.
Let me hit stop.